स्टूडेंट्स, अ वेरी गुड मॉर्निंग. सो टुडे लेट्स डिस्कस द रेस्ट ऑफ द क्वेश्चंस ऑफ सैम्पल पेपर दैट इज इशूड बाई द CBSE. सो हियर वी हैव डिस्कस्ड अप टू 17th नंबर क्वेश्चन. सो लेट्स डिस्कस फ्रॉम द 18th नंबर क्वेश्चंस नाउ. सो द क्वेश्चन नंबर 18 इज गिवेन हियर ऑन द स्क्रीन, दैट इज हॉरिजॉन्टल कंपोनेंट ऑफ अर्थ्स मैग्नेटिक फील्ड एट अ प्लेस इज रूट 3 टाइम्स द वर्टिकल कंपोनेंट. So it means if horizontal component is BH, then it is given, it is root 3 times vertical component, that is VV. So the angle of dip at that place will be what? So we know that angle of dip is connected with the horizontal and vertical component by the relation tan delta, and tan delta is equal to BV upon BH. So in the case of relationships between these all parameters, we have seen this relation. So as BV by BH, now you can see, and from this relationship you can just find out its value. It is obtained as 1 by root 3, and we know 1 by root 3 is the value of tan of 30 degree. So it means that angle of dip is what? That is 30 degree. So as angle of dip is 30, then in radian it will be pi by 6. The next question is a small angle between magnetic axis and geographic axis at the place is. So you know the angle between magnetic axis and the geographic axis is called angle of declination, or we are also calling it magnetic declination. So this is, by the definition you can write this one, that is equal to magnetic declination. Now next question, let's see. This is two coil are placed close to each other. So the mutual inductance of the pair of coils depends on. So we know that whenever in one coil there is change in flux, there will be the change in flux with another coil already, and this is called mutual inductance. So let's see the mutual inductance for which this one is correct. So first option is given, rate at which the current change in the two coils. Second is given, the relative position and orientation of the coil, rate at which voltage induced across the two coils, and current in the two coils. So here as mutual inductance is what, it is depending on the second coil. Like in the first coil, if there is a change in flux occur, then that time in second coil automatically flux change will occur. So it means that the first coil, what is its position and what is orientation, that is very important. As you know, like you have two of the coils, one coil is oriented in this way and another coil is oriented in this way. In this case, as you will see, they are oriented in perpendicular direction, then that's why their mutual inductance becomes zero. So this time no mutual inductance we will obtain, as no change in flux will occur due to one another in each other. So mutual inductance is also depending on the orientation in which way we are orienting them. So that's why you can say that option number 2 is correct for this one. The next question is, a conducting square loop of side L and resistance R moves in its plane with a uniform velocity B perpendicular to one of its side. The magnetic induction B constant in time and space pointing perpendicular and into the paper of the loop exist everywhere as shown in figure. So what is the current induced in the loop? Sorry. So in this case, the figure is given. You can see in this figure, the magnetic field is represented by the cross lines, and you know what the cross line are just showing us. So cross line are showing that the magnetic field is perpendicular to the plane of paper. And one more thing, as B is now given, the coil, it is moving with a uniform velocity B. It is given now that has loop L and resistance R, then what will be the, you can say there is the magnetic flux that is now produced. So magnetic flux production, how can you just understand? So the EMF, that is produced in electromagnetic induction, that is equal to rate of change of flux. And we know if E by R we will calculate, then that will provide you the induction current. So it means that induction current is depending on the induced EMF, and induced EMF is depending on the rate of change of flux. So in this example, if you will see, as there is no rate of change of flux with time, because if you will see now B, area of the loop and orientation of the loop, all the are constant, and we can change the flux by three methods, that is phi is equal to, you know, BA cos theta, sometimes number of turns also, but here number of turns concept is not given. So magnetic field is constant, area is constant, theta is constant, as all are constant, then phi that will be constant even the loop is moving. So with the movement of loop, as there will be no effect on the flux, and finally no production of the EMF, no production of the current in the circuit. So our first option is now current here, zero here, sorry, last option, not first option. The next one question, let's see. Question is, the magnetic flux linked with the coil in wave is given by the equation. Here equation is given to us between pi and time. So induced EMF in the coil at the time t equal to 4 we have to find out. So this is very easy question. As you know, E is equal to what? Minus of d pi by dt. Minus sign, you know what it is indicating? It is given by the Lenz law. So that is showing us the induced EMF is opposing the reason due to which it is produced. So now let's just calculate d pi by dt. So let's differentiate the equation here. This is given with respect to time. So if we will just differentiate pi with respect to time, then here pi t square we have. So that will be now 10t, and 3t plus 3t, this will be now 3, and 16 as it is constant, this will be 0. Now as this is our induced EMF, and negative sign also included here everywhere, so just keep them in bracket. So one more time, one second. E is equal to, we have minus of 15t. I think it is not 15t. It is now, yes, it is 10t. 5 into 2, 10t, then plus 3 we have. Now let's put the value of time here, t is equal to 4. So if you will put t is equal to 4, then this is 10 into 4, that will be 40, then plus 3. So finally we will have 43, and here with minus sign, this is it, minus 43 volt. So this is our answer of the question now. Next question, let's see. Which of the following graphs represent the variation of current with frequency in an AC circuit containing a pure capacitor? So if in any AC circuit, if there is the pure capacitor, then for pure capacitor, one thing you know, here the reactance of the capacitor, that is what? 1 upon omega C. So 1 upon omega C, if you will convert into the frequency, then this is obtained as 2 pi fc. So here we have to find out what is the variation of current with frequency. So we know current is equal to potential upon, if potential upon this one, reactance means E by Z we can write down. And now you will calculate, then it is obtained as E 2 pi fc. So from here, if voltage is constant, 2 pi is constant, capacitor is, value is constant, then I is directly proportional to the frequency of the capacitor. So we have just derived the concept, that is I is directly proportional to the frequency. So as for this type of proportionality, we have the graph, that is linear graph. So this is third option is now correct for our question. Let's see the next question now. The next question is, a 20 volt AC is applied to a circuit consisting of a resistance and a coil with negligible resistance. So a voltage across the resistance is 12 volt. The voltage across the coil will be what? So here question number 24, it is given to us that is 20 volt AC supply is to a circuit containing resistor and a coil with negligible resistance. So suppose this is our resistor and this is now a coil and this is now connected with an AC source. So 20 volt AC we have just used here. So this is now connected to this one, clear? So here this coil that we have, suppose this coil has the inductance L, then this will have potential drop across this coil will be VL. A potential drop across the resistor is suppose VR. So here as both are connected in series, then these potentials, their addition will be equal to 20 volt AC supply. So let's see, now we have to find out as what will be the value of here 20 volt AC supply. Then first, as this is now, you can see our LR circuit. So in the case of LR circuit, we have drawn the phasor diagram. So let's draw the phasor diagram of this one. So first in the case of phasor diagram, as we know, for the pure resistive circuit, current and voltage both are in the same phase. So if this is the, suppose the direction of our voltage here, so this is direction of voltage and direction of current for the resistor also. So this is the direction of, you can say, VR. I think just a second. Yeah, this is now VR. Then we know that in the, you can say, inductive circuit. So in inductive circuit, voltage is leading, voltage is not leading, that is lagging the, exactly, lagging behind the current. So at, here, one more time, let's see the phasor diagram as it was very complicated actually. Yeah, this one, this is the direction of our resistance, means VR, the resistor we have used, and this is also the direction of current here. So as in the case of inductive circuit, voltage leads the current by the 90 degree angle. So this is the phase between, as this is the VR and I is the direction of current and voltage, then this is the direction of VL. So this VR and VL you can see now. And as this one you have seen, then you can just understand it by the vector one. Like this is the vector VR, this is vector VL. Because we are in phasor diagram, what we are using, we are rotating vector we are using. Now we can just make such kind of parallelogram. Then the resultant of these two vectors will be represented by the diagonal of this parallelogram. And by the formula, we can write down V net. This is given by root of VR square plus VL square plus 2VR VL cos phi. So as cos phi is equal to 90 degree, because phase between VR and VL, that is 90 degree, so that will be 0. Directly I have written this one value. Now what we have to do, we have to write down the value of these all, and we have to solve our question. So in the case of VR, as it is given voltage across the resistance, it is given 12 volt, so this will be 144. VL we don't know, we have to find out. And here this V net is given, that is 20 volt. So 20 volt, if you will write, this is now 20. Now what you have to do, you have to take a square on both sides, then you have to solve, and after solution you will find out what is the value of VL. So the value of VL is obtained as equal to 16 volt. So you can solve and you can see this will be the 16 volt. Now the next one and the last question of section A, that is the instantaneous value of EMF and current in a series AC circuit is given by this one. Then what can you just say about the information through the circuit? So as first, let's see the instantaneous value of EMF. This is E is equal to E0 sin omega t. For second one, I is equal to I0 sin omega t plus pi by 3. Here what you are seeing the phase in the current that is equal to plus pi by 3. So you know positive phase we are observing only in the case of you can say our capacitors, means as their current leads the potential, like in inductive, in our inductive circuit, in L circuit we are seeing that potential is leading the current, but in the capacitive circuit current is leading the potential. So here if by our equation we can see our current is leading by the phase pi by 3 the potential. So circuit must have the, first of all that should be capacitive circuit. Now if capacitor is made the connection with the resistor, then RC circuit can be here, that is also possible. And along with RC circuit, what is the possible next one? LCR is also possible. Let's see why LCR circuit is possible. You know, in LCR circuit, whenever the capacitor is dominating over the inductor, then that time LCR circuit start to behave like the capacitive circuit. And in that case, current start to lead the potential. So that's why this circuit can be RC as well as that can be LCR circuit. So now with the these discussions, section A questions are now covered. Let's see what is now section B questions. So in this section again we have 24 multiple choice questions in which you have to attempt 20, but we will discuss whole of the question here. So let's discuss number 26 number question. So a cylinder of radius R and length L is placed in uniform electric field parallel to the axis of the cylinder. So here suppose this is now our cylinder and this one, and that we have to do that total flux for the surface of the cylinder is given by, so the cylindrical surface, you will see this is the cylindrical surface. So in the cylindrical surface, if you will see electric field is parallel to the axis. So if electric field is parallel to the circuit, it means axis, it means that whatever the here total flux that will enter to the cylinder, that will leaves to the cylinder also. So as net flux enclosed by the cylinder will be there equal to zero. So this is our answer of the question. Now 27th number question, let's see. Two parallel large thin metal sheets have equal surface densities, 26.4 into 10 power minus 12 coulomb per meter square of opposite signs. The electric field between these sheets now. So what will be the electric field between the sheets? So for this one, you have to use the formula for the parallel sheet capacitors we can also use. So in that one case, we have already seen the between the two parallel plate capacitors or parallel plate sheets, the electric field is given by sigma upon epsilon 0. So let's use the formula here directly to solve the question. As sigma, it has value 26.4. Just a second. So here electric field, this is now 26.4 into 10 to the power minus of 12 and then divided by epsilon 0, that has value, you know already, this is 8.85 into 10 to the power minus 12. So here this value you will solve, this will comes into the Newton per coulomb, not second. So here from here 10 power minus 12 will be cancelled out, and if you will solve this equation, then its value is obtained as 3 Newton per coulomb. So this is our answer of the question now. Let's see the next question. Consider an uncharged conducting sphere. A positive point charge is placed outside the sphere. So the net charge on the sphere is then will be what? So suppose this is now our uncharged conducting sphere and a point charge is placed outside the sphere. Then here the question is asked for the net charge on the sphere. So which of the option will be now correct? So for the option, let's see, this is नेगेटिव एंड यूनिफॉर्मली डिस्ट्रीब्यूटेड ओवर द स्फीयर. सेकेंड ऑप्शन पॉजिटिव एंड यूनिफॉर्मली डिस्ट्रीब्यूटेड ओवर द सरफेस ऑफ द स्फीयर. नेगेटिव एंड अपीयर्स एट अ पॉइंट द सरफेस ऑफ स्फीयर क्लोजेस्ट टू द पॉइंट चार्ज एंड देन लास्ट वन इज ज़ीरो. सो एज इक्वल एंड अपोजिट चार्जेस दैट विल बी इंड्यूस्ड ड्यू टू दिस चार्ज. सो दिस इज़ द पॉजिटिव चार्ज दैट विल इंड्यूस द नेगेटिव चार्ज एयर नियर टू द सरफेस, बट द पॉजिटिव चार्ज दैट विल ऑल्सो इंड्यूस टू न्यूट्रलाइज दिस वन बिकॉज इन साइड दियर नो ऑफ द चार्ज. सो पॉजिटिव चार्ज विल ऑल्सो इंड्यूस्ड हियर. सो फाइनली यू कैन सी इक्वल एंड अपोजिट चार्जेस विल अपीयर ऑन द नियर बाई कंडक्टर ड्यू टू इंडक्शन प्रोसेस. सो इन इंडक्शन प्रोसेस यू कैन सी दिस इफेक्ट, बट द नेट चार्ज यू विल सी इनक्लोज बाई द सर्फेस दैट विल बी स्टिल जीरो. सो दिस इज अवर ऑप्शन. नाउ लेट्स सी द नेक्स्ट क्वेश्चन. थ्री चार्जेस 2 कूलम माइनस कूलम एंड देन सॉरी 2q माइनस क्यू देन माइनस क्यू लाई एट वर्टिसेज ऑफ अ ट्राइंगल. सो द वैल्यू ऑफ ई एंड बी एट सेंट्रॉयड ऑफ द ट्राइंगल विल बी वॉट. सो सेंट्रॉयड ऑफ द ट्राइंगल इज वॉट. फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल दिस इज अवर सपोज ट्राइंगल. इन दिस ट्राइंगल इफ यू विल जस्ट लेट्स जस्ट एक्सटेंड दियर द मीन्स हियर. सो द पॉइंट ऑन एट विच दे आर मीटिंग दैट इज कॉल्ड सेंट्रॉयड. सो वी हैव टू जस्ट फाइंड आउट द इलेक्ट्रिक फील्ड एंड पोटेंशियल एट द सेंट्रॉयड ऑफ द ट्राइंगल फॉर दिस ऑल कॉन्फिग्रेशन. सो एज यू नो द इलेक्ट्रिक फील्ड दैट विल बी एट सेंट्रॉयड this will not be equal to zero because some of the electric field you will find out here. The net potential you have to, if you will find out, then net potential will be zero there. Why? Let's see the potential, why it is zero. So as due to 2 coulomb potential will be equal to, due to point charge potential kq by r. So let's use the same formula. So suppose the distance between from the vertices of centroid it r, then this will be k 2q into r, small q is written, then this write this one, then plus again k into small q divided by r minus y I have written due to minus sign of the charge, then again k q by r, again minus sign is given. So overall if you will add then this will becomes zero. So v will be zero but e will not be zero. Why e is not zero? So as suppose this is our centroid point, this is now suppose 2q, this is minus q, this is minus q. So you have to see the direction of first electric field. So direction of electric field is positive in this direction, this there will be the electric field, and here in this case electric field's direction is outside. Again in this case this is like this one. So here as these are all the directions of electric fields, then their net effect that will not be zero exactly because these three are not going to cancel out each other. So E will not be equal to zero but V is equal to zero here. So third option is now correct. Next question, question number 30, let's see. Two parallel plate capacitors X and Y have the same area of the plate and same separation between plates. So X has air and Y with dielectric of constant 2, so between its plates. So they are connected in series to a battery of 12 volt. The ratio of electrostatic energy stored in X and Y is now. So here it is given that we have two capacitors. Suppose one capacitor is this one. Now the second capacitor is this one. They are connected in parallel with the battery of 12 volt. This is the our circuit is given, and here it is given that in between this one capacitor air is present, then in between this one a dielectric is present and that has dielectric constant K is equal to now 2. So this is all information I think now this is conveyed. Then let's see the capacity of the first one. So capacity of X this is equal to epsilon 0 A by D. So here as it is, air is here, so there will be no effect now. And capacity of Y, if you will see, So this is now, you know, K epsilon 0 A by D. With dielectric constant, capacity becomes K epsilon 0 A by D here. So if K its value you will write down, that will be equal to 2 now. So let's just find out now the energies here. So if energy we will find out finally, then this is now equal to the Ux. This will be equal to half CB square or Q square by 2C. Because why Q square I am taking, I will just tell you. First let's write Uy. This is Q square upon 2CY exactly. As you know, in series combination, the charge on each capacitor, that will be same. So that's why we have taken this one. We haven't taken the concept of half CB square, because potential at each capacitor, that will be different in series combination. So due to this one, now let's see the ratio of Ux, then Ux upon Uy. So if you will calculate the ratio, then this ratio is obtained as Cy by Cx. And now Cy, as it was 2 times Cx, so you will find out the ratio of the energies is 2:1. So third option is now correct. The next one, let's see next option. Which among the following is not a cause of for power loss in transformers? So as power loss effects we have seen in transformers, and the reasons are also seen by you, 4 of the reasons we have seen. So let's see which one is not the exactly reason for the power loss. So first is, eddy currents are produced in the soft iron cores of the transformer. You know, eddy currents are already responsible for the here transformer power loss. Second one, electric flux sharing is not properly done in primary or secondary coils. Yes, this one is also a reason for the power loss in transformer, because whenever the electric flux sharing is not properly done, then that time flux linkage loss occur, and due to that loss also there is power loss. Third loss is produced humming sound produced in the transformer due to the magnetostruction. So this one also we have seen, there is a lot of humming sounds produced in the in transformer core, and that's why this is also reason of power loss. Then last one, let's see, primary coil is made up of the very thick coil. So exactly, thick wire is not our problem, and due to that one there is no power loss. So that's why this is not the reason in the power loss in the transformer. The next question, let's see, an alternating voltage source of variable angular frequency omega w and fixed amplitude V are is connected in series with a capacitance C and electric bulb of resistance R, inductance 0, then W is increased. So here in this case what it is saying, there is a bulb, suppose we have this is now the bulb, and it is connected through a capacitor and a potential source, clear? So here the angular frequency of the variable source is given W, and the fixed voltage is given V, that is connected through this bulb that has resistance R, and the capacitor that has capacity C now. So what we have is asked to us, if W is now increased, means angular frequency is now increasing, then what will be the effect on the bulb exactly? So you know that in RC circuit, the reactance of the circuit is equal to 1 upon omega C. So if omega is W, whatever you are writing, so suppose W is it is. So if W, that is angular frequency, this is now increasing, then due to increase in angular frequency, this chi C, this will now decrease. And due to decrease in chi C, means in here you can say the reactance of the circuit is now decreasing. So chi C, if it is starting to decrease, then due to decrease in chi C, what is the current in the circuit, that will increase now. As you know, resistance will decrease, then current will increase here. So if current is going to increase, then bulb will what? This will start to glow brighter now. So bulb will start with greater brightness. So option number second is now correct. Let's see the next question. A solid spherical conductor has charge plus Q and radius R. It is surrounded by a solid spherical cell with charge minus Q, inner radius 2R and outer radius 3R. Which of the following statement is true? So here in this figure you can see solid spherical conductor that has charge plus Q and radius R. So the small one you will see where A to B point is given, that has equal to R, and now it is surrounded by the solid spherical cell of charge minus Q. The white part between the two dotted portions you can see that has this one, you will see this one has AC, this is distance 2R, and then outer one AD, you will see that is equal to 3R. So let's see the some of the points are given and we have to just find out which statement is true here. First one is given, the electric potential has the maximum value at C and electric field has a maximum amplitude at A. The second one is given here in this question. The electric potential has a maximum magnitude at D and the electric field has a maximum magnitude at B. Third one, the electric potential at A is 0. The electric field has a maximum magnitude as D. Both the potential and field achieve a maximum magnitude at B. So let's one more time let's see now the figure. So in this figure you will see all the statements exactly. So in all statement if you will see now the point B, then at point B there will be the maximum value of potential as well as maximum value of current, because the potential and field both are varying inversely with the distance. So it means that they will have the maximum value at B already. So whenever they will go further or the distance will increase, then they will decrease now. So they will not have the maximum value at D or C, they will have the maximum value at B. So let's see one more and last question here of today. That is, a battery is connected to a conductor of non-uniform cross-sectional area. So the quantity which remain constant is. So here a battery is connected to, you can see the conductor of non-uniform cross-sectional area. Then in this case, correct option? So electric field will be conserved. Drift velocity and electric field is conserved, electric field and current is conserved, or only current is conserved. So in non-uniform cross section, drift velocity, as it is depending on the resistance and resistance is depending on the cross sectional area, so that will change. Electric field is also depending, that will change. So here there is not change only in the option, that is the last option, that is current. So in the case of current only, this is not depending on the cross sectional area, because this is following the, you can say, equation of continuity. So for that one case, as here you can see, this is not simply depending on that will be remains constant, but other all factors as depending on, they are depending on the cross sectional area, that's why they will change. So with this discussion on 34 questions now, let's end our class here. So some more questions are still here, so in next class we will see all these questions. So for today, let's end our class here, guys. Thank you.